Good afternoon, and welcome to Baker Donaldson's Financial Services webinar on electronic funds transfers and litigation risks. This is Christine Roberts. I chair Baker Donaldson's Financial Services Department. I will be presenting today along with my colleague, Katie Dysart. Katie and I are both shareholders in our financial services litigation and compliance group. I'm in Memphis and she is in New Orleans. We both focus our practices on representing financial institutions in a variety of litigation matters. We're very excited to present this program and hope that today's webinar will provide you with a basic overview of electronic funds transfers, key cases, and litigation risks. We'll also be sharing some strategies for preparing for and avoiding litigation. Before we get started, we do have a few housekeeping reminders. Attendees are able to submit questions via the Q&A box on your screen. We will likely not get to all the questions during the webinar, given the material we need to cover, but please be assured that we'll follow up with you offline as we don't expect to get to many questions, if at all, today. Attendees are able to download a copy of the presentation in the resource list, and it will also be emailed to you in the coming days. We also ask you to complete the survey at the end of the webinar and submit your feedback. We do read it carefully and take it into consideration for future programming. One other reminder, and this one's really important, we have a few, exactly two polling questions during the webinar. Please remember to submit your answers to the polling questions as we present the topics to be eligible for CLE credit. As we'll talk about at the end of the program, we have applied for credit in Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Texas, and we work closely with you to help you self-submit in other jurisdictions. With that, we are ready to begin, and I'll turn it over to Katie.
Thank you, Christine. It's a pleasure to be able to speak with all of you today. And nothing kicks off a webinar quite like this fun depiction of the overview of a funds transfer. And if you start here at the top left, you'll see that we start with the originator, who then sends instructions to pay money to the originator's bank. That originator's bank either goes through its own internal funds transfer system or an intermediary bank, if that's necessary. Those funds then get transferred to the beneficiary's bank. Money gets placed into the beneficiary's account and goes to the beneficiary. That is the general overview of the funds transfers in which Christine and I will discuss today in various contexts. So what law applies in the context of these funds transfers? Well, UCC Article 4A governs the basic elements of any electronic funds transfer, including Fedwire, CHIPS, SWIFT, Telex, book transfers. Those are all transfers of credit across a single bank's book from one account to another. The UCC Article 4A does not cover transactions that are governed by the Electronic Fund Transfer Act, which we sometimes refer to as EFTA, and we will discuss the EFTA and some relevant cases later on today. Article 4A does allocate the risk and responsibilities with respect to mistakes and errors. It does not account for, the account agreements that are actually between a specific customer and a bank, the contract, so to speak, can alter certain provisions, but cannot otherwise diverge from those provisions. In the context of bank-to-bank relationships, the National Automated Clearinghouse Association, or the NACHA, provides operating rules for the ACH transactions, which apply from bank to bank. And Christine will discuss those in a lot more detail later. So what can go wrong? Well, oftentimes, fraud can happen pretty often. And in fact, there was a recent report that was done by the FBI Internet Crime Report, which averaged potential losses from business email compromise complaints to nearly $2.4 billion. Now, notably, that report was done in 2021. So that statistic has probably gone up substantially with the advancement of social engineering and hacking. And when we talk about social engineering, what we're referring to is any kind of technique that's aimed at getting a target into revealing specific information or performing a certain action for illegitimate reasons. We all know what hacking is, right? It can also arise from other scenarios, including rogue employees. If there are any lawyers on this call, which I know that there are, I'm sure that you've seen the rogue bookkeeper cases. Those have been quite prevalent. Or in the context of error or miscommunication. And we'll get into some of those cases as we go on today. Here's our first poll question. Can't tell you what you will gain, if anything, from getting a correct answer, but here we go. An employee of a bank gets a phone call purporting to be a customer, directing that it send a wire from his account. Turns out that request was fraudulent. The wire is sent anyway, and the funds are not recovered. Who bears the burden of that loss? If you will kindly use your mouse to submit your answer. Your answer will be anonymous, but we are collecting. We're hoping to get an average of at least 50% submitted before Christine reports back with the poll result.
And as a friendly reminder, this is important for CLE credit. So please click on an answer, even if you're not sure what the answer is. All right, let's go ahead and see what everyone has guessed. Ooh, looks like a pretty close split between bank and it depends. And the answer, every lawyer's favorite answer to a question is it depends. As Katie said earlier, Article 4A of the UCC governs the rights, duties, and liabilities of banks and their commercial customers with respect to funds transfers. So what we're talking about here in the case of an unauthorized transfer is who bears that loss. Is it the customer whose funds were transferred or the bank that carried out the unauthorized transfer of funds? In general, the originator, basically the customer, is not obligated to pay an unauthorized transfer unless the bank followed agreed upon security procedures and acted in good faith, and those security procedures are deemed to be commercially reasonable. So if those two conditions are met, if there were agreed upon security procedures, acted in good faith, and the procedures are commercially reasonable, then the customer, not the bank, is responsible. If the bank can show commercial reasonableness, the customer can attempt to shift the loss back to the bank if it can show that the transaction was not directly or indirectly caused by the customer, its employees, agents, someone with access to the customer's facilities, or someone who got the information from a source controlled by the customer. So that can be a tough standard for a customer because the customer, in effect, is having to prove a negative. So let's talk about commercially reasonable security procedures as the cases talk a lot about that question. And so the key question here is, what does it mean to follow a commercially reasonable security procedure? And really, what is reasonable for that financial institution? The courts have said that this is a question of law. And the purpose is to incentivize banks to institute reasonable safeguards, but at the same time, not make them insurers against any and all fraud. And as the UCC has defined it, as the drafters have considered it, it's not whether it's the absolute best available security procedure, but it's a reasonable to the standard. Is that procedure reasonable for the particular customer and the particular bank? which is a lower standard, not the same as is it the best possible security procedure. And at the same time, if a security procedure fails to meet prevailing standards of good banking practice applicable to that particular bank, it's not going to be found to be commercially reasonable. So, you know, in effect, what this means is that what is commercially reasonable depends in large part on the financial institution. The drafters of the UCC decided that one thing that's important is what type of bank are we dealing with? What type of customer are we dealing with? If it's a bank that's larger, more sophisticated, it might be held to a different standard than a smaller community bank. So the key question is, what is a good banking practice applicable to the bank in question? We're going to talk about a couple of cases that get into the nitty-gritty on commercial reasonableness. The cases we're going to talk about are all about 10 years old, but they remain the key cases that other courts talk about time and time again. So, and I would encourage folks who do work in this area to read these cases. They really do a good job of providing a background on Article 4A, how the drafters intended Article 4A to work with existing remedies and other legal doctrines, and generally how they were trying to determine, you know, the rights and duties of parties and allocate loss. So let's talk first about the Patco case, which came out of the First Circuit Court of Appeals. In that case, thieves stole almost $600,000 through six fraudulent electronic transactions after they were able to provide Patco's customized answers to specific security questions. Notably, the bank's system had flagged all six transactions as high risk, because they were inconsistent with the timing, dollar amount, and geographic location of Patco's regular payment orders, which were generally for weekly payroll. But no one at the bank notified the customer. And so in that case, the bank security procedure were found to be unreasonable, in effect, because the standard was the same for all clients. Regardless of amount, regardless of any other factor, including those with high dollar value transactions, or, you know, where there was some increased risk involved. So, in effect, because high risk transactions were not treated any differently and did not, in practice, were not given any additional scrutiny, the court found that to be unreasonable. Another factor that was, you know, a contributing reason for the outcome here was that other comparable banks, similar situated banks, were using tokens, physical devices such as a smart card or a password generating token, as part of a multi-factor authentication system. And because the bank in question here did not have that, that was part of the reason why the bank security procedures were found to be unreasonable. Another key case from around the same time period is the Choice Escrow case out of the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals. That case involved almost $500,000 in stolen funds through fraudulent wire transfers. The customer was a real estate escrow service provider. They filed suit against their bank. In that case, the court found in the bank's favor because it found that what the bank did was commercially reasonable in terms of their security procedures. The execution of the wire transfers were consistent with the customer's expectations, and the bank complied with all the customer's instructions. And what's particularly notable about this case is that the bank offered, as part of its security procedures, they offered dual control, but the customer declined to use it and signed a waiver saying that they understood the risks of using a single control. And so, you know, a dual control system is one in which, you know, when the customer submits a payment order, it doesn't go to the bank immediately. Instead, It creates a pending payment order that appears in a separate queue, and a second authorized user from the customer using a unique user ID and password has to log in and separately approve it. And so because that was a system that was offered by the bank, but the customer declined to use it, the court determined that in that instance, the customer would bear the risk of loss from a fraudulent payment order. So, you know, what the UCC says about all of this is a security procedure will be deemed to be commercially reasonable if the security procedure was chosen by the customer after the bank offered and the customer refused a security procedure that was commercially reasonable for that customer, and the customer expressly agreed in writing to be bound by any payment order, whether or not authorized, issued in its name and accepted by the bank in compliance with the security procedure that the customer chose. Because all those factors were satisfied here, the bank prevailed. One more case I'd like to talk about on commercial reasonableness. This is a case that came out of a district court in Michigan, again, about 10 years ago. And this case involved criminals who had hijacked the customer's bank accounts through an email phishing scheme. As you know, Katie mentioned earlier, you know, email can be a source of a lot of the fraud that happens in this sector. Almost $2 million were transferred to various destinations around the world. The court found that the bank followed its security procedures. However, the court also found that the bank did not act in good faith when it accepted the payment orders. Specifically, what happened here was that there were about 97 different wire transfers that came in within the span of a few hours. And in each instance, money was being sent to Russia, Estonia, and or China. And so what happened was, looking at this customer's previous history, they'd only done two wire transfers, I think in the span of a couple of years. And so in this instance, the court found that the bank, not the customer, was liable because the bank could not have acted in good faith when it accepted the payment orders. In effect, that the court held that under these circumstances, the bank, if it had been acting, you know, fairly with its customer, would have detected and or stopped the fraudulent wire activity earlier. All right, so it's time for your second polling question. We're going to turn to another topic, which Katie's going to address, but we're going to introduce it to through a polling question to see what you guys know already. And the question is, what happens when a bank receives a wire transfer intended for customer A, but the account number listed belongs to customer B? What should the court, or sorry, the court, what should the bank do? A, deposit the money in an account belonging to customer A. B, deposit the money in an account number listed on the wire transfer, customer's B's account, or reject the deposit of wired funds altogether. So let's go ahead and give you all a chance to take a look, take a stab at answering. We will not hold anyone to their answers. All right, looks like the consensus is reject the deposit. The interesting answer is, again, it's sort of a lawyerly answer. Any of these can be correct, as Katie's going to explain further. And it depends on the facts and circumstances of each case. So if the bank is unaware of the discrepancy, it can deposit the funds based on the account number alone. And why this is the case is that most wires are handled automatically. And the whole purpose of the rules is to design is to promote fast resolution of wires. However, if the bank is aware of the discrepancy that there's a, you know, an account number tied to some name and a different name on the wire, and the bank deposits the money in the customer B's account, in that instance, the bank bears the risk of loss, but you're all very, you know, being careful. And so, as we say here, the safest approach is just to reject the payment. If you're aware of some issue, if you're actually aware of a discrepancy. So, Katie, you want to take it away and talk to us a little bit more about discrepancies?
Sure thing. So these cases really show what courts consider in the context of what is and is not a discrepancy. And what you'll see from the cases that we will discuss today is that really it hinges upon whether there was actual knowledge by the bank in terms of the discrepancy. This first case, Corfin versus Ocean Bank, involved a discrepancy in an account number. In that case, the beneficiary's bank actually noticed a discrepancy in an account number and deposited a $72,972 wire. Now, the originator bank realized that mistake and sent another wire to the right account. The beneficiary, however, withdrew all the money from both wires. The originator's bank sued, and the beneficiary's bank was found liable for improperly accepting that first wire when it had notice of the erroneous account number. The beneficiary bank was found to have, quote unquote, breached a duty of care by not rejecting that first wire when it had noticed that it was erroneous. This next case is the Shapiro versus Wells Fargo case out of the 11th Circuit in 2019. In that case, the beneficiary bank was alleged to have had knowledge of a misdescription of a beneficiary as opposed to the account number. So it was the name of the beneficiary. Now, this case arose out of a fraudulent wire instruction sent to a beneficiary from a fraudster. And the beneficiary's bank defended the claim because it did not have actual knowledge. That's notable because there was an actual manual review once there was a realization of the potential fraud by the Office of Foreign Assets Control Compliance, and they did find a possible name mismatch, but they could not confirm a name mismatch. The fact that the name of the intended beneficiary in this case was actually James Messenger, and it didn't match the name of the owner of the Wells Fargo account, which was identified in Shapiro's payment order, which was Chris Ashibi. Now, the initial automatic system reflected that there was a possible name mismatch, but no individual person at that time was aware of that. Notwithstanding that possible name mismatch, Wells Fargo's MTS processed the wire as it was programmed to do, because the account number in the payment order actually matched a valid Wells Fargo account number. Although the wire was manually screened because of this possible mismatch by an actual individual for the Office of Foreign Assets Control for compliance purposes, the parties didn't dispute that there was no individual at Wells Fargo, including the OFAC screener, who obtained actual knowledge of the discrepancy of the possible name mismatch in Shapiro's payment order. And therefore, absent actual knowledge, there was no liability found. The next case, and you'll see these cases really, show you that, you know, facts can really change and it depending on the jurisdiction as well, but you know, for the most part, it really hinges upon actual knowledge. The Nirov Ingredients case versus Wells Fargo, in that instance, the account number and name on the wire identified different persons. And so the bank was found to be able to rely on the number as opposed to the name as a proper identification of the beneficiary, as long as it didn't have actual knowledge that the name and number referred to different persons. In that instance, it did not, and so it was not found to have actual knowledge of the discrepancy. In the Flaherty versus Wells Fargo case, this involved an attorney in Switzerland who was pursuing his bank after he was personally convinced to wire 30 grand into a bank account, believing that it was his American co-counsel's account. Once he discovered the fraud, he sued the bank for not refunding him the money and said that the bank should have known that the owner of the account identified by that account number was different from the beneficiary on the wire transfer. Now, the complaint must facially plead the claim of knowledge. It can't just claim that there's a possibility of misconduct. And in that instance, the court actually found that the bank did not have actual knowledge of the discrepancy and did not permit recovery under UCC 4A. So the moral of that story is possible knowledge is not enough. Now, it's important to note in the context of UCC Article 4A, which we've been talking about, that the rules that are articulated in that article are really intended to be exclusive. In determining the rights, duties, liabilities of affected parties in any situation covered by those provisions. The comment provides for that specifically. And this effectively preempts liability for any action that's authorized by the statute. So courts and the jurisprudence really can't create rights, duties, or liabilities that are inconsistent with the actual UCC Article 4A. So most courts look for actions that fall outside of the scope of what's permitted in terms of Article 4A. Now, what does this mean? Well, let's look at some examples. So the Regions Bank versus Provident Bank case, 11th Circuit, has been very active in this presentation. In that instance, that there was the state law claim that was filed required that the beneficiary's bank disgorge fraudulent received funds that were not preempted. So anything that didn't fall specifically with the UCC in terms of state law claims were the only ones that the court would look at in order to require the bank to disgorge any fraudulently received funds. In this next case, this was in the Northern District of Texas in 2012. State law claims were filed allowing a beneficiary's bank who failed to return funds that knew it was wired in error, it allowed for state law to supplement there and allow the bank to actually return those funds. The key here was there was actual knowledge. Again, we see that actual knowledge coming back in the Northern District of Texas. In the Narav ingredients, which we talked about a moment ago, in that particular case, there were also state law claims involving a negligence claim relating to the beneficiary's bank allowing that hacker to open a checking account. Those were allowed so long as they didn't, they weren't inconsistent with the UCC Article 4A. In the 3T oil and gas case versus JP Morgan Bank, state law claims were also allowed for negligent misrepresentation where post-wire assurances that funds were flagged and couldn't be withdrawn, but were later withdrawn. They found no confirmed misconduct there, and those state law claims were allowed. In the SNS Worldwide case, that involved a wire fraud claim outside of the context of UCC 4A. And in that wire fraud claim suit, the bank processed the transfer based on a name and account discrepancy. Once it involved that name and account discrepancy, it was found to be preempted by UCC 4A. So these cases are exemplary in terms of what is and isn't preempted by UCC Article 4A, which we've discussed in the first half of this presentation. The $900 million mistake. Now, this case is interesting because it involves a rarely accepted but worthy of discussion defense in the context of these cases that we've been discussing. And it involves the In Re Citibank August 11, 2020 wire transfers. Now, this case is very interesting and I'll walk you through it. So Citibank was acting in its capacity as an agent for a syndicated term loan taken out by Revlon. The key here is that it was a term loan and you'll see why later. They intended to wire about $7.8 million just in interest payments to Revlon's lenders. Now, instead, Citibank mistakenly wired almost $900 million of its own money. Now, the resulting payments equaled, interestingly enough, the amounts of both principal and interest that Revlon actually owed on the loan to its lenders. So Citibank files suit in New York against the recipients to try to recover the funds. Now, generally speaking, the law treats a failure to return funds wired by mistake as unjust enrichment or conversion, right? And it requires that the recipient return the money to its sender. But there are certain jurisdictions in very, very limited circumstances that will recognize this very narrow defense called the discharge for value defense. And in this instance, the recipient would be allowed to keep the funds if they are discharging a valid debt. The recipient cannot have made any misrepresentations to induce that payment, and the recipient cannot have notice of the mistake. The district court in Citibank determined that the discharge for value defense in New York applied, and thus Citibank was not entitled to its money back. Instead, the defendants were entitled, the lenders were entitled to keep all $900 million. Of course, it was appealed, and as a New York Court of Appeal court explained, when a beneficiary receives money to which it's entitled and has no knowledge that the money was erroneously wired, the beneficiary should not have to wonder whether it can retain the funds. Rather, the beneficiary should be able to consider the funds transfer as a full and complete transaction, not subject to revocation, because it's a valid debt, right? Now, this is an exception, again, that's only recognized by a handful of states. So depending on which jurisdiction you are, you'll want to check and see if this is a valid defense in your jurisdiction in terms of mistake of fact. Now, almost 2 years after that district court's disfavored opinion, the Second Circuit reversed it on account of two errors and completely vacated the lower court's decision on two bases. The first was that the recipients had constructive knowledge of Citibank's error, and the discharge for value rule doesn't shield the beneficiary of a mistaken transfer for restitution if they're on notice of that mistake. They also found, and this is the very interesting part of it, that the recipients were not yet entitled to payment because, as we discussed in a couple slides ago, this was a term debt loan. And while the entire amount was technically owed, it was not yet due or presently due at the time of the mistake. Therefore, the court held that the discharge for value rule did not apply. As you can see, where this exception applies, it can be pretty critical and for an exorbitant amount. The Second Circuit did save Citi in this instance. The last we checked, it appeared that 10 of the Revlon creditors who had refused to return the collective $504 million from the mistaken payment in 2020 began settlement proceedings after the appellate court ruling. And as of December of 2022, about 75% of the $900 wire had been returned to Citibank. Now, interestingly enough, despite somewhat of restitution, the Federal Reserve and Office of the Comptroller of the Currency, OCC, ordered Citi in October of 22, presumably because of this Revlon blunder, to improve its risk management, data, and internal controls. And they actually fined the bank $400 million. So what is the takeaway here? A lot of banks are now adding clauses in the form of accidental payment clauses into debt documents, and that allows the banks to demand the repayment of any money that's actually sent by mistake. A lot of these clauses that we're seeing banks build in actually give the bank not only the sole power to determine whether a payment was made by mistake, but also to demand repayment, and it sets forth usually certain procedures by which they can demand repayment. And if those procedures are followed, then the covenant is usually upheld or should be upheld. Now, outside of the UCC, Article 4, and the limited defense that we've talked about, the Electronic Fund Transfer Act, we briefly touched upon in our introduction. And so we'll cover it a bit in these next couple of slides. The Electronic Fund Transfer Act is often referred to as the EFTA. It establishes the rights, liabilities, and responsibilities of any participants in the electronic fund transfer systems. This is where it gets fun in terms of the different portals that this provision actually applies to. Now, it requires financial institutions to adopt certain practices and procedures regarding transaction accounting, error resolution, and it requires financial institutions and others to have certain procedures in place for pre-authorized transfers, liability limits for losses that have been caused by unauthorized transfers. It also requires financial institutions to disclose important information to consumers before such transactions. It also provides consumers with protections related to unauthorized transactions. Now, how does this all play out? An unauthorized electronic fund transfer under the FTA is simply an electronic transfer from a consumer's account initiated by someone other than the consumer and without authority to initiate that transfer, and from which the consumer receives no benefit. Now, this is important because sometimes there will be a claim by a consumer that's actually, you know, done in concert with the consumer in order to try to obtain some benefit back. And that's what the next bullet point applies to. It says that this does not include an electronic funds transfer that's been initiated by someone who has furnished access device to the consumer's account. Now, this can come up oftentimes in businesses with respect to folks who are given access to business accounts, passwords, et cetera. It also doesn't apply in the instance of a fraudulent intent by the consumer or by any person acting in concert with the consumer, or it doesn't apply to the financial institution and or its employees. What does this cover? Modern payment systems. This is where it gets interesting. I'm sure everyone on this webinar has been on Venmo, Zelle, Cash App, PayPal, et cetera. These are called peer-to-peer platforms, and the EFTA applies to all of those. And with the increase in popularity of all of these systems, it's important to keep an eye on the EFTA and recent developments. These platforms are subject to the EFTA, and the banks allowing electronic transfers through those platforms must send required disclosures to the consumers or to their customers. They must also comply with certain procedures, including consumer notifications, if opted into, investigation of unauthorized EFTs, so they're required to investigate under certain circumstances. They're required to resolve any alleged fraudulent or unauthorized EFTs within specific timeframes. What are those timeframes? We'll get into those in the next couple of slides. Before we do, we'll touch upon one recent and notable EFTA case involving a Chase customer who alleged she was the victim of unauthorized electronic fund transfers from her checking account at Chase. She claimed that identity thieves made a series of unauthorized withdrawals that ultimately totaled over $500,000. Now, all of these transactions took place somewhere in the ballpark of 2017 and 2019. What's important in this case is that in November of 2017, Chase flagged a $29,000 charge as fraudulent. The customer was reimbursed from the acquiring bank, but Chase took no other precautions to protect the customer's account from unauthorized transfers, or the court found that in any event. Now, Chase reimbursed the customer, but also refused to pay $300,000 of the stolen funds. She then sued Chase for violating the Electronic Funds Transfer Act and said that the bank had a higher liability than the EFTA allows for. As we discussed, there's a certain time frame within which reporting must occur. The court in this case looked at that time frame, and there's a 60-day period that that's required for consumers to report. And in this instance, a consumer may be held liable for any unauthorized transfers that occur after that 60-day reporting period if the bank establishes that the transfers would have occurred but for the failure of the consumer to timely report the earlier unauthorized transfers reflected on the bank statements. So that would cover, in this instance, anything from 2017 until 60 days before the 2019 ones. But the court in this instance found that even if she had reported the unauthorized transfers within 60 days of each unauthorized transfer, that the subsequent transfers that occurred after that 2017 instance that ultimately accumulated to 500 grand would have occurred anyway. And so she sought reimbursement and was able to get some of the funds back because the court found that the bank failed to protect her account from the instance in November of 2017 and forward. Now, Christine's going to get into some of the specifics of ACH transactions, which, as we talked about earlier, also fall outside of the scope of the UCC and are separate and apart from EFTA.
Yeah, thank you, Katie. So far we've talked about Article 4A of the UCC, which applies to business accounts, and then the Electronic Fund Transfer Act that applies to consumer accounts. Here's one other area to think about, which is ACH transactions. ACH transactions or transfers rather are bank-to-bank money transfers that are processed through the automated clearinghouse network, hence ACH. And they really have experienced tremendous growth over the past couple of years. Last year, they totaled over $77 trillion in transfers through the ACH network. Just 2 years ago, in 2020, there were $62 trillion in ACH transfers through the ACH network. So, you know, that's a huge increase, $15 trillion of growth in just 2 years. So really kind of mind-boggling there. The entity that governs the network is NACHA. It has its own set of rules that apply to allocate fraud losses, including it imposes specific warranties on what it calls the originating depository financial institution and those entities warrant that the transfers initiated by its customers are properly authorized. And, you know, to explain that growth, ACH these days is just used for all kinds of fund transfer transactions. You know, we see it in direct deposits of paychecks, monthly debits for routine payments. What the ACH network allows is that pre-authorized both credits and debits can be automatically posted as a means to electronically transfer funds to and from banks' customers' accounts. We see, you know, merchants often enable customers to pay their bills via ACH by providing an account number and a bank routing number. A number of online payment services also conduct transactions via ACH, really including most banks and credit unions' online bill payment services. So this seems like something that certainly is here to stay and is only grown exponentially in the recent years. You know, there is not as much case law in the ACH area, but we wanted to talk about a couple of cases that we think are significant. One is an older case from about 20 years ago. One is a case from last year. The Security First case out of the Northern District of Illinois involved a criminal actor that debited $1.5 million in false ACH debit authorizations against customers of a couple of different financial institutions. What the court was dealing with were motions to dismiss filed by the banks in response to customer claims. Basically, the customers argued that by issuing debits from their accounts, the bank, as the originating depository financial institution, was warranting, pursuant to the NACHA operating rules, that customers had properly authorized debits. In this case, the court agreed that the claim for breach of warranty was a viable claim sufficient to survive a motion to dismiss. So the basic claim that was allowed to go forward was a breach of warranty claim based on the NACHA rules. fast forward 20 years to the Azure College case, which was decided less than a year ago in the Southern District of Florida. In that case, again, a criminal actor impersonated a college president and contacted a payroll company, provided the college's bank account number, routing number, and was able to initiate more than $250,000 in ACH debits against the college's Bank of America account. In that case, it wasn't a motion to dismiss, it was a motion for summary judgment, and the bank prevailed. The claim there was a different claim. It was breach of contract, not breach of warranty. But the court held that the bank was not required to recredit the account holder for the unauthorized transactions based on the NACHA rules that were incorporated by reference into the depositor agreement between the bank and the customer. So interestingly, why was there an apparent contrary result in the Azure College case? As I mentioned, the claim in that case was not a breach of warranty claim, but it was a breach of contract claim. According to the Southern District of Florida, the applicable depositor agreement incorporated the NACHA rules, and the NACHA rules state that there is a two-day reporting requirement, specifically the deadline for a return entry to an ACH operator is no later than the opening of business on the second banking day following the settlement date of the original entry. Notably, the court in that case said that the plaintiff had complained that because it would have no recourse under the NACHA rules, it should be allowed to recover, and said, court, in effect, if you let the bank win, I have no remedy, I have no recourse. What the court said is, and it's an interesting note in the case, it's in a footnote, the court says, I'm going to find the exact footnote because it's interesting, court says, in its brief, plaintiff suggests that a remedy against defendant is appropriate in part because plaintiff would have no recourse against any other person or entity under the NACHA rules. The court, however, is not so sure. And then there that the court goes on to cite the first security case that we just talked about from the Northern District of Illinois, which suggests that the key may be how the claim is pled and what causes of action are brought. So interesting set of cases there. And one final note is in addition to other remedies, a financial institution can report violations of the rules directly to NACHA. That there is an enforcement team there that investigates claims and can assess fines to financial institutions for non-compliance with its rules. So something else to be aware of there. Okay, so as we start thinking about, what does all this mean? What kind of conclusions can we draw and takeaways here? Obviously the best thing, the ideal situation is if we can avoid fraudulent transfers to begin with. The more financial institutions can put into place policies and procedures, conduct training, and implement technical solutions, the better. We list some of the options here in terms of what procedures can be in place, such as requiring employees to verify wire information or bank information by calling a known telephone number. This can be really important when you're dealing with, new wire information that may be different from original instructions during the course of a transaction. Things like international wires should be scrutinized more than others. Dollar amounts are important to consider Real estate transactions are often targeted here. And so, you know, providing a lot of training for employees, making sure that that employees who have to deal with wire transfers are prepared for these situations is just really important. Another safeguard is making sure that you have written agreements with your customers prior to wiring their funds so that everybody is clear on what the expectations are and what the ground rules are. Multi-factor authentication is something that we talk about a lot. That's certainly important. And then, again, like I mentioned, there are technical solutions and including technical alerts for anything that is suspicious, whether it's from internet providers outside the U.S. or other things that are suspicious. And education, educating customers, educating business partners, putting out warnings about wire fraud, making sure that we are all vigilant and kind of view these transactions with some amount of heightened concern and skepticism helps as well.
Christine, before you move on to the next slide, one of the best practices that you noted was written agreements there, and we don't have it in this PowerPoint presentation, but I think it's important to note that a lot of banks are including in those written agreements arbitration clauses. And we found that when we were looking at the recent litigation trends, that a lot of cases that were filed were compelled into arbitration. And so we couldn't figure out what the result was, but it's important to note that arbitration clauses are being inserted into those agreements and are being upheld in the context of specifically EFTA cases in which we saw in presenting and preparing for our presentation.
What if you're in the situation where, we're not talking about litigation yet, but you suspect that some sort of fraudulent transaction has occurred? We always counsel clients, work with your legal counsel, whether it's your in-house lawyers or seek out your outside counsel, whether it's Baker Donaldson or someone else. It is really important to engage with legal counsel and work to develop an incident response plan. We certainly have expertise here at the firm and can refer you to resources to help in that situation. Gathering information, again, it helps to have the under the guise of attorney-client privilege to determine, when did the fraud occur, who was involved, what were we talking about in terms of dollar amounts, and what accounts were involved, who in terms of, we're talking about business customers, consumers, who's associated with that account. It's important to attempt to recall lost funds from the financial institution to which they were transferred, to reach out to your insurance provider and look for any applicable policy provisions that might provide coverage for the situation. In some cases, it's important to work with law enforcement. I know, a lot of our clients work closely, their security departments work closely with law enforcement, but both so that law enforcement can assist, but also so that the authorities are involved in, understanding the latest trends and pitfalls that are out there that then they can in turn, help educate other financial institutions in the public about fraudulent schemes that are prevalent. And as I mentioned earlier, if there are transaction partners or entities that are not adhering to the NACHA rules, another option is reporting those violations to NACHA directly. Finally, if you are involved in litigation, a couple of thoughts about that. As you can see from the cases we talked about, when there are significant losses, lawsuits are not a surprising result. So, just to be prepared for what can happen, having litigation holds in place, putting in place promptly when you're notified of a lawsuit, being prepared for discovery, which can get into sensitive issues about security procedures, In some instances, it's possible to freeze funds. In some cases, it's appropriate to interplead funds into court. Because oftentimes, once funds are gone, it can really be difficult to recover them. I think we went through some cases where that was not the case, and we were able to, banks were able to recover funds. But, oftentimes, once the money is gone, it's gone. Other options are entering into hold harmless agreements in connection with recalling wires. As Katie mentioned, agreements, with your customers are really important. Thinking about what terms are there. She mentioned arbitration provisions, but, thinking about indemnification provisions and, what you can do to protect your institution, as well as, have clear expectations and understanding with customers as to who's responsible for what, that really can be important in these situations. All right. With that, we have a couple of final notes before we wrap up. First and foremost, this program has been submitted for 1 hour of CLE credit in 5 jurisdictions: Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Texas. But that being said, we always want to work with you if you're not in those jurisdictions, or if you have additional states you need to submit materials to. We can provide materials for submissions to other states. As the slide says, you'll receive a thank you email that contains multiple links, including one to submit your state and bar number, and one with a downloadable certificate of attendance. So if you have questions about that, we are certainly happy to help and make sure that you get CLE credit. In addition, all of the listeners on today's webinar will be receiving the PowerPoint slides. And as a final note, we are always looking for ways to better serve the financial services industry. If you have ideas about future programming, CLEs you'd like to have us present, or any other ways our law firm can be of assistance to you, please let us know. So thank you so much to everyone for joining us today. We really enjoy doing this.
Yes, thank you very much.